So for my band booked line art jumble, I have downloaded several resources that are in my downloads folder. I have more than five already. They're all from Pixabay, and I know they're good quality. I can open up any one of them, and they're nice and big. I can zoom in on them and see that the pixels are nice and clean. Notice that some of them are not as black as other ones, right? It just depends how they were uploaded. This looks a lot duller gray than this one. But I'm going to show you how in Photoshop, or you can use Photopea, we're going to standardize them all to black eventually. So as long as they're high quality references, we can use them. The problem is maybe there's something that I don't have that I want. Maybe I want a more traditional switchblade and I just didn't find it in Creative Commons Open. Or maybe I want sunglasses, but I want those very specific kind of 1950s sunglasses. And I don't like all of the options here. So next I'm going to show you Google Images, which you're probably familiar with. It's just like Google search, but you notice that Google Image Search is different than a regular Google search. And if I type in switchblade knife and I hit return, very similar to Pixabay, it's going to give me images. And unlike Pixabay, it's going to give me millions of images. So immediately, I need to start limiting these. To do that, you click on Tools at the top of the image, Google's image search bar. This is important. This will save you a lot of heartache. Never do a Google image search for artwork where you're not limiting under tools. The first thing we're going to limit is we need them to be large enough. Google used to be a lot better this way. It used to have actual resolution options, and you could search for things only 10,000 pixels or larger, right? Now they just have large, medium, and icon size. Large simply means 1,000 pixels or bigger, which is barely big enough. But that's going to encapsulate everything that's larger than 1,000 pixels in one dimension. In terms of color for this project, we just want black and white. But notice that's going to include a lot of black and white photographs as well. So then under type, we want to use not illustration like we did in Pixabay, but line drawing. And then under usage rights, this is not foolproof, but it is nice they have this search term. We can look for Creative Commons licenses as opposed to commercial, usual copyright licenses. And of course, there aren't any with Creative Commons licenses, or we would have seen them probably on Pixabay. So I have to go to all, but look at all the different options I have. So here are some of the issues you come across with Google Image Search. This one is the kind of thing I want, but I'm going to right click and open it in a new tab. But when I actually look at it big, notice that it's 1,000 pixels by 1,000 pixels, so it's just barely big enough. But when I zoom in on it, and often what I'll do is I'll right click and I'll say open image in new tab from this screen so I can see it at full resolution and zoom in, you can see that it's got watermarks all over it, right? And that's not a big deal. If I want to use it for my creative work as a student, I'm allowed to use it, but I have to spend the time erasing all those watermarks, especially where they overlap with the black. But you know what? I'm going to go ahead and show you that because that's kind of the worst case scenario and it can be dealt with. And so I'm going to save that to downloads. Let's see if we can find something a little bit better. Man, 1950s switchblades have really gone out of style. I'm seeing more kukris. This is a good one. It's a fishing knife, but it'll work. So you open it in a new tab, and then you right click and say open image in new tab. And now I can zoom in and I can see it. This is the other problem with Google Images. Unlike Pixabay, they aren't vetted first. So it looks good small, but then when I really zoom in, this is pretty distorted. This is what's been called bitmapped. So its lines have been turned into tiny, like, exact black pixels. And maybe that works, but it's not as clean as some of the other stuff I've used. So it's always good to know the quality of your sources. And then lastly, I'll just look for some sunglasses. All right, if I do a Google image search for sunglasses, remember I need to do the tools. I need to limit its size to large. I need to limit its color to black and white for this project. I need to limit its type to line drawing. And I can try limiting its usage rights to Creative Commons. And it does have some results then. And if it's under Creative Commons, you're not going to get things like watermarks, right? It doesn't always mean that they're labeled correctly, because this relies a lot more on machine learning than something like Pixabay does. And that's also why I kind of like doing Google image searches, because you get random stuff, right? You'll never get that on Pixabay. Why am I getting geishas and the Venus de Milo and sun graphics when I'm searching for sunglasses, right? But sometimes that can get you to think in new ways. Like, I really love this image. Even though it has nothing to do with the outsiders. And I might open that image in a new tab, make sure it's good quality. Zoom in with just Command Plus. Yeah, it's pretty cool. But not for this project. Now, there's Peppa Pig. The problem is Peppa Pig is owned by PBS, right? There's no way that should be Creative Commons. So, you know, take all of this with a healthy dose of skepticism. And this will also allow me to show you how to track down where the image comes from. So if I take this one, I open it, open link in a new tab. I can open the image. This has got a really large pixel dimension, which is great. I can open the image in a new tab. Remember, we want at least 1,000 inches. I can zoom in. I can see it's good quality. But where does it come from? So we can also look at the source link. And this comes from Wikimedia Commons, which is a Creative Commons site. But you want to look and see what attributions it has. So this is what's called Creative Commons attribution. So to use this and to use it in a way where it's recognizable and not transformed, I'm allowed to use it, but I have to give credit. Appropriate credit, which means I'd have to give a link to this page, right? So other people could find it, if I'm going to put it out there commercially. And that's why you'll often see with posters and things online, a little asterisk at the bottom and it says sources and it will have links. So that's how you track down your resources. Again, as a student and myself as a teacher, I can use these things for educational purposes, but I can't sell them. It's also why I can't make my YouTube channel a for-profit channel. Okay, so I'm going to save that image. I'm going to right-click, save the image. It's going to go to my downloads folder. And now I've got to organize. I've got plenty of images to use. So if I go back to my instructions, I've got all these images. Now I need to open up either Photopea or Photoshop, and I need to set the criteria for what's called the physical format. That's how many pixels there are. I want it to fit within an 8-inch by 10-inch piece of paper. You can expand that to 10 by 10 inches if you want to go more square, but you don't want to go smaller. The way you do it, either in Photoshop or in Photopea, is once you have a file open, you can go to Image and then canvas size. This is also how you can grow it if it's too small or if you want to change it. Image at the top and then canvas size. That's what it says in your step-by-step directions. So even if you didn't set it up correctly, you can always check that it's right. So I have an 8x10. I'm going to go ahead and change it to 10x10 because you can always go bigger than 8x10, but 8x10 is the minimum. And what this is about is it shows where it's going to add from. So this will add from the very center of the image, even though I don't have anything on the image. And then the canvas extension color is going to stay white. That sounds fine. So now I have an image that is 10x10 inches, but then I also want to look at what the resolution is. And for that, you go to image and image size. So I want you to know the difference, and we'll be repeating this a lot, between image size and canvas size. Canvas size is the physical format that you're putting imagery on. Image size is the pixel resolution within that format. So in image size, this is 10 inches by 10 inches. Note that this is inches, not pixels. And it's good to have the physical dimensions be in inches. And then the resolution, the minimum resolution for this project is standard minimum print resolution. That's 300 pixels per inch. What I usually do is I make it 350. That's what I call our lab standard. It's always good to have a little bit bigger. Whenever I send a project to a client, I have it a little bit higher resolution than they asked for, because sometimes they want to zoom in, or sometimes they want to stretch it out or make it a little bit bigger in the layout. And you want to have enough resolution for that. Why don't I put 3,500 for resolution if bigger resolution is better? Well, the more resolution you have, the slower the computer works. And if I put 3,000 resolution, then my 1,000 pixel images are going to look really small and they're going to look really distorted. So it's all based on the quality of what we're compositing. But 350 should be safe. This resample, that allows me to change the pixel amounts within the image. Because computers are good at resampling. It's just, it looks terrible when you make the computer make up information. So computers are great at downsampling. They're really bad at upsampling, no matter what crime shows tell you about, like, cleaning up security footage. It's really difficult for a computer to do that well. Okay, so we have 10 by 10 inches, can be 8 by 10 or bigger. It's by a 300, it's at 300 pixels per inch. And now we have a workspace. Whether we're in Photoshop or whether we're in Photo P, now I need to place my images. So the first thing I need to do is find my images. They're all in my downloads folder. My downloads folder is particularly messy. That's not going to change this semester. But what I can do is I can organize it. And that's what I want you to do. So if you have your images either on your desktop or in your downloads folder, I want you to right-click and create a new folder. And I want you to name that folder exercise number one. You're going to be responsible for organizing your own work. This is my suggestion, right? Within this folder, I can drag all these references. I can even drag my screenshot of the banned book, right? So they're all in that folder. That makes it easier to see, makes it easier to work with and work from. I'm going to start with the image that I think I'm most sure I want to use. And it's this one. So there's a few ways I can start. I can right-click on this. And I can say, open this with Photoshop. That would be like opening an image into Photo P online. But then I would want to go to image canvas size, just like it says in the directions, and make sure that it's 10 inches by, or 8 inches by 10 inches or bigger. And when I do that, it really crops my image. That's because these images we got online are all different sizes and resolution. So when you open the image directly from online, it's best to go first to image size to see what you're dealing with. So this image is 19 inches by 26 inches, but it's only at 72 resolution.